Good afternoon. This is Mark Watt, Senior Consultant with the Alberta Medical Association. I'll be moderating the session this afternoon. Welcome to the AMA's Business Viability in Times of Crisis webinar. Please note that the information provided during this webinar is current as of April 8th and may be subject to change. This webinar has been approved for up to one main pro credit. The evaluation link will be displayed in a web browser when you leave the Zoom meeting. Today, we will hear from Marianne Loney, partner with McLennan Ross, specializing in corporate commercial securities. Marianne, can I have you come on camera and mic and say hello?
Hi.
Thank you, Marianne. Maurice Dransfeld, partner with McLennan Ross, specializing in labor and employment law. Maurice, can I have you come on camera and say hello?
Hello.
Thank you. Dr. Scott Wilson, neurologist and president of the section of neurology. Dr. Wilson, can I have you come on camera and say hello?
Hello. Good afternoon to everybody.
Thank you. And Dr. Daryl LeBuick, family physician and executive with the section of family medicine. Can I have you say hello, Dr. LeBuick?
Hello, everyone.
Great. Thank you so much. The question and answer feature is being monitored by experts in the following areas: law, billing, human resources, financial planning, insurance, and peer support. We extend our thanks today to these individuals for their time, their expertise, and their support of this session today. Please feel free to ask questions through the Q&A if you have questions related to these topics or others. Please note that the webinar you're participating in is being recorded. By participating, you understand and consent to the webinar being made publicly available via a link on the AMA website for an undetermined length of time. By participating in the question and answer feature, your name entered into the Zoom sign-in will be visible for other participants during the webinar and or in the recording. We would like to recognize that we are webcasting from and to many different parts of Alberta today. The province of Alberta is located on Treaty 6, Treaty 7, and Treaty 8 territory and is a traditional meeting ground and home for many Indigenous peoples. This program has not received any financial or in-kind support. The Planning Committee has contributed to the consideration of learning needs, the determination of learning objectives, the development of program content, and the choice of speakers. No sponsorship funds have been received, and the Planning Committee has reviewed the content of the presentations and ensured the content presented is as evidence-based and free of undue influence. Myself, Marianne, and Maurice have received compensation for our time and preparation. Drs. Wilson and LeBuick have no disclosures. This webinar is being provided to offer advice and guidance on business support programs, subsidies, human resource practices, and practical tips to maintain business viability. In addition to the specific topics displayed, we have planned for 45 minutes of question and answer. Before we hear from our first presenter, I would like to invite Vic Taylor, AED, Corporate Affairs with AMA, to extend a welcome.
Thank you very much, Mark. On behalf of the AMA, we recognize that Alberta physicians are experiencing tremendous change and are facing unprecedented challenges in our health system, in their lives, and in their practices. We thank you for your commitment and dedication to serving Albertans at a time when you are being personally impacted and challenged. As a professional association, we know we are stronger together. And as we move forward collectively, we are pleased to offer this webinar to provide you with information, to answer your many questions, and to address your many concerns. We know discussions like these will need to continue beyond today, and we will continue to support you along that way. Thank you once again for joining us this morning and this afternoon. I'd now like to turn things over to Marianne Loney. Thank you.
Hi, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, everyone. Before I dive into the government announcements regarding what government support is available, I'd like to just make a couple comments. First of all, I would like to emphasize that it's critically important that you keep good records at this time. I know when you're under financial strain, it's really easy to let that slide, but this can make a really big difference in the long term. and can have a big impact on what you are eligible for and what potentially you can claim. So specifically, I'd like to mention losses. The CRA really likes to deny losses if you don't have proper records. So for example, bad debts, you need to keep good records of what collective action you've taken. So emails, telephone calls, any payment plans, and personal losses on loans. So if there's been loans made to a business, in order for a loan to be deductible, either as a capital loss or as a business investment loss, you need to be able to show it was for the purpose of earning income. For a shareholder, if you want to do a personal loan to your corporation, for example, this is less of an issue because you can always earn dividends. However, it's worth noting that loans from family members, for example, you want to charge interest on those loans because they need to show that there was a purpose of earning income. Because if the loan was not paid off, then they won't be able to claim the loss. So the interest doesn't have to be payable immediately, but it is worthwhile to have a small amount of interest charged on loans. In terms of the COVID-19 specific measures, we don't really know what documentation is going to be required yet. However, we strongly recommend you keep track of what you've paid to whom and when, especially when it comes to payroll and any payroll related payments. When it comes to non-arm's length employees, you want to be especially careful about that. So that's either employees who are shareholders or their family members are usually non-arm's length employers, especially if they were hired, and for any employees, especially if they were hired kind of after March 15th. And then you want to keep records of your calculations if determining what you're eligible for. With regard to this presentation, I'd like to point out, and not that everybody doesn't know, this is moving really, really fast. So this presentation was prepared yesterday, and I've made some comments or updates to my speaking notes literally like 20 minutes ago, right? So the government's always announcing new things. New things are coming on the government website, and things are going to change after this. I expect that some of the things that I've said today are not going to be true in a week or two because it will change. And I'm 100% certain that we don't have all the details right now, which I will go into. So keep that in mind. We have produced a guide, which is available on the AMA website that covers this. And we do plan on updating it. And we do produce updates on the McLennan Ross website. So there are sources you can go to. And obviously the government is producing lots of updates as well. So I'm going to start and the biggest part of my presentation is going to be dealing with the Canada Emergency Wage Subsidy, which everyone considers or probably calls the 75% wage subsidy. This is probably the most significant economic measure the government has announced to date. It's certainly the most significant for employers. This provides a subsidy to employers of up to 75% of their employees, quote unquote, pre-crisis remuneration, up to a maximum salary of $58,700. So that $58,700 number, that's the maximum pensionable earnings. So the maximum CPP earnings is where that number came from. The way the math works is you have an annual salary of $58,700. You divide that by 52 weeks, and then you multiply that number, the weekly amount, by 75%. And that's where you get the $847. However, note that employees who earn less than $58,700, their subsidy would be proportionally down for their week pay. There's no limit to how many employees you can claim the subsidy for. So in theory, there's no limit to how big this subsidy can be. For example, Air Canada has specifically said they're going to hire back 16,000 and change of their laid off employees because of this subsidy. So they're assuming they can claim it for all their employees. Eligible employers is pretty broad. It includes individuals, taxable corporations, partnerships, not-for-profits, and charities. So pretty much as long as it's not a public entity, it probably will apply. However, the big thing, the big gateway here is going to be the revenue test. Eligible employers need to be able to show that they had a 30% drop in revenue. Now, this can be a month over month drop. So this would be a comparison to the month a year ago. So April 2019 would be compared to April 2020. And then yesterday, they also indicated that you can do this as a comparison to January and February 2020 if the year over year doesn't make sense. So for example, new businesses and growing businesses, they may choose to do an average January and February revenue and compare that. I forgot to mention, they also announced yesterday the revenue decrease for March only has to be 15% because the crisis only started in mid-March. In terms of how you calculate revenue, there are two ways you can calculate revenue. You can calculate revenue using the accrual method, which is usually what most businesses use, is the accrual method, or using a cash accounting method. Usually farmers and small businesses only use this. And it basically comes down to really cash in, cash out. This is important to a lot of people because if your accounts receivable is going up, because you maybe you're issuing invoices, but you're not actually getting the cash, this cash method could resolve that particular concern. And then also yesterday, the government announced that for employees that you're continuing to pay, but who are not working, so furloughed employees, they will refund 100% of the employer portion of EI and CPP. And this is a big cost for employees, so that's great to hear as well. Next slide, please. So now the big issue with this 75% subsidy is we don't have the legislation yet. The government has indicated that the legislation should come soon. They're going to call Parliament back soon to pass it. That being said, we don't have any dates. And until we see the legislation, it could change. We know, for example, that CPA Canada and the Canadian Tax Foundation made some comments to the government about some of their concerns with what had been announced to date. And I'm sure opposition MPs will also have commentary. So, you know, this is all to a certain extent up in the air. However, they have already announced some negative things that it's important to keep in mind. First of all, the subsidy is taxable income, so it would need to be included as taxable income. However, salary and wages are deductible, so it should even out in the sense that you don't get extra amounts that you're not, it's not deductible. That being said, it's something to keep in mind. And second, the government has indicated that there will be very severe penalties for people that abuse this. So my understanding is they're going to try to make it fairly easy to claim it. We'll just have to sort of say you have a right to it, but there could be some pretty significant consequences, potentially even jail time. And they've said up to 5 years in jail if there's fraud going on, right? So again, we don't have the legislation, but from comments they've made, it sounds like if you, in good faith, do your calculation and pay their subsidy to your employees, you may have to pay it back and there might be some interest or whatever, but there shouldn't be significant penalties beyond that. However, if you, for example, claim the subsidy and then pocket it, you could be looking at potentially jail time. So that's something to keep in mind. There are a lot of significant unknowns that you need to be aware of that are going to impact what the potential subsidy is. So a good one, for example, is what is pre-crisis remuneration? The government has indicated that new employees, at least new arm's length employees, would be able to use this subsidy. But how does that apply to if you had a part-time employee? Does that mean you cannot give a part-time employee, you can't bring them up to full-time, for example, but you can hire a new employee? That's not clear. They have said, or suggested at least, that in terms of calculating pre-crisis remuneration, they're going to look at January to March 15th, 2020, and that you can exclude 7 days and any weeks where you were not earning any revenue. So new hires, potentially, you won't have to include like January if you hire them in February, for example. And you can maybe exclude like holidays or whatever, like those 7 day periods with holidays. Updates yesterday suggested that not-for-profits, so this is an example of things have changed since the slides, not-for-profits like charities will be able to exclude government revenue or not, is what they seem to be saying. And the government has also suggested that there will be a special rule for non-arm's length employees. So it's not clear what that rule will be, and it's this is significant because shareholders usually would be non-arm's length employees, or at least often will be non-arm's length employees, and their family members. And what it sounds like the way it'll work is that if the non-arm's length employee was hired before March 15th, they would still be eligible for the subsidy, but you can't just hire all your family, you know, now and claim the subsidy. Similarly, the government has also announced there'll be specific rules for corporate groups, non-arm's length entities, and joint ventures. We don't know anything about what those special rules could be, but they could be important. So the government acknowledges that there's still things that are potentially need to be addressed. We are waiting for information regarding the application process still. I would assume, based on, again, comments and the way some of the other stuff has been working, that you'll be able to apply online through My Business account. So I strongly recommend, if you do not already have a My Business account, you set it up. It can take up to 2 weeks to get the info or to get the code from the CRA, which you need to set up My Business account. So if you don't have it, I would try to set it up right away, start the process of getting that set up. The government has indicated they're going to try to have it that we can apply for this subsidy within 3 weeks, up to 6 weeks. So if you get set up now, you should still be able to apply as soon as you can make that application process. Again, we don't know what's going to be the payment method, but we assume that if you're set up for automatic deposits into your business account, then the government will deposit them automatically. And if you aren't, it would be checks, which would be much slower. So you would probably want to be set up for automatic deposits as well. And then we're not sure how this is going to interact with payroll source deductions, because in theory, payroll source deductions are going to apply. So is the government going to reduce the amount of the subsidy to take that into account, or are people going to have to then turn around and remit payroll source deductions? And finally, the government has indicated that you will not be able to be eligible for the Canada Emergency Response Benefit, which Maurice is going to address further in his part of the presentation. And we don't know how this is going to work. It may be that employees who were laid off and claim the CERB will have to cancel it or repay it if they're then rehired. And then just one final thing before we pass this slide. It's worth noting that the government did announce that the Canada Summer Job Subsidy, they're going to pay 100% of minimum wage for eligible employers, and there's 70,000 potential positions there. So I don't know if this is going to be something that would be useful, but it might be something worth looking into if you want to hire students. All right, so the other wage subsidy, which was announced before the 75% wage subsidy, is the temporary wage subsidy, which is 10%. This one is up to $1,375 per employee, up to a maximum of $25,000 per employer. Eligible employers are individuals and CCPCs with less than 15 million taxable capital employed in Canada. And this is kind of a complicated definition, but basically really what this just means is any corporation that was able to claim the small business deduction would be an eligible employer. Partnerships that comprise of other eligible employers, not-for-profits, and registered charities. For partnerships, the legislation indicates that provided all the partners or individuals or corporations that have some small business limit, the partnership should be able to apply for this 10% subsidy. It's worth noting that this is received by reducing your payroll source deductions or your remittances, not source deductions, you still have to deduct them the same amount, but how much you remit to the government. And because you do this yourself, you don't have to wait for the government to pay you. What this means is if for example, for your March payroll, when you're making your payroll source deductions April 15th, if you haven't already made them, potentially you can reduce the amount you have to pay in the next few days. So that's worth noting. An eligible employer cannot claim both the 75% subsidy and the 10% subsidy. So if you've claimed the 10% subsidy, it will reduce the amount you are eligible for the 75% subsidy. Eligible employees are basically just anybody employed in Canada. So there's no limitation on non-arm's length employees, and there is no reduction in revenue required. So in theory, a small business corporation could claim this subsidy, the 10% subsidy, even if it cannot claim the 75% subsidy, and then obviously vice versa. Next slide, please. So I'm going to kind of fly through these next couple slides because we're kind of short on time. Basically, there's all sorts of payment deferrals and filing deferrals. The main thing you need to know is that there's no deferral for payroll source deduction remittances, except basically the reduction due to the 10% subsidy. Also, you need to know it's just a deferral. That means you're going to have to pay it eventually. And GST and payroll directors are jointly and severally liable. So you want to make sure that that does get paid. Next slide, please. In terms of loans, the government has announced a whole bunch of loans and things that they're doing to try to make credit available. The main thing to know about this is that they're all through your regular financial institution, so you're going to have to go through your regular financial institution. I will add that probably the most interesting one is the Canada Emergency Business Account, which would be an interest-free loan of up to $40,000, and it would be interest-free until December 2022, and you would potentially only have to pay back $30,000 of that. In order to qualify for this, you need to have payroll between $50,000 and $1 million. So if your business fits in that payroll amount, that's something you might want to look into as well. Next slide, please. All right, so now I'm going to talk about some examples. Now, these are just examples, and there's so many different situations out there. So I know these won't necessarily apply to everyone. So if you have specific questions, please send them and we'll try to address them. But this is just to give you an idea of how these will work. So for example, for the 75% wage subsidy, you'd have to, let's assume that the PC, which is the corporation, employs the receptionist and nurse. In order to be eligible, the employer must have a 30% drop in current month revenue compared to the same month last year. I'm just ignoring the 15% for March and the option of using January and February for these examples. So basically, if you have that 30% drop, they would qualify. Then the subsidy is 75% of the wages with a maximum of $58,700. Let's assume the nurse makes $58,700 or more. So the nurse would qualify for the full $847 per week subsidy. Let's assume that the receptionist only earns $40,000 a year though. So for them, it would be proportionally down, which would end up being $577 per week. So the total subsidy that this PC could claim would be $1,424 per week. If the sole practitioner has been paying himself or herself as an employee, they may be also eligible for the subsidy. Again, non-arm's length employee, we don't know for sure, but assuming that they've been doing that regularly, they likely would also be eligible. The 10% wage subsidy, they would potentially be eligible for as well, assuming they're a Canadian-controlled private corporation with less than $15 million of taxable capital. Note that that $15 million of taxable capital is shared with associated corporations. So if there are associated corporations, when I say associate, I mean the tax term, which is related to control and related parties, something you can talk to your accountant about, that can potentially have a limit here. But assuming that it meets the test, and it could claim the small business deduction, the 10% wage subsidy would also apply. So in theory, this sole practitioner could reduce the payroll source deductions even before it can get the 75% subsidy. The payroll source deduction subsidy would be, again, the maximum of $1,375 for the nurse, and it would be reduced for the administrative assistant. So based on my rough calculations, they would get They would get a total of $2,375 for all 3 months of the subsidy. Now, note that's for 3 months. So this would only be $114.58 for the nurse and $83 per week for the receptionist. So it's a lot lower, which makes sense because it's 10% rather than 75% than the 1,424 per week that the sole practitioner would get on, under the 75% subsidy. Very quickly, the Canada Emergency Business Loan, that $40,000 loan, their payroll is $125,000, which is above the $50,000. So again, you'd want to check with your financial institution, but it looks like they may qualify for that $40,000 loan as well. Next slide, please. So this one is a slightly larger group. It's either a partnership or a corporation where there are three shareholders who are physicians. So I'm assuming that the staff physician, the associate physician, is an employee, but if they're being paid as a contractor, they would not qualify for the wage subsidies. If they're being paid as an employee, they would potentially. In terms of the 75% wage subsidy, so the key issue here is going to be who is the employer and can the employer show a 30% reduction in revenue or 15% in marge? And you're gonna have to look at what your actual structures are. So if it's a partnership or a corporation that is operating the clinic and all the revenue is going through there, then the calculation should probably work pretty much the way it's supposed to. I know that some medical practices work with a structure where you have sort of an expense company that's set up that handles the clinic expenses. And then the physicians or the physician corporations pay their share of expenses. So this may be a situation where, at least with what is announced to date, this subsidy may not be available. Because if you're paying fixed costs of expenses, your revenue is, at least on the surface, not going to go down by 30% necessarily, unless the physicians put in 30% less money. So we're not quite sure how this is going to work. And I am optimistic that there may be announcements that will deal with this kind of situation, because there were comments from the government that future announcements were coming with regard to corporate groups, for example, which might cover this. But as of what has been announced today, again, we don't have the legislation and there's more coming, I'm sure. This may be a situation where it may be hard to show that 30% revenue drop, even if the physicians themselves are earning 30% less revenue. However, for the sake of our example, we're going to assume that it's a partnership or a corporation that does have the 30% drop, and so it can make the claim. So we assume the revenue has gone down by 30%. Applying the same math that we used before, assuming the admin staff are earning $40,000 a year and everyone else is earning more than $58,700, the potential subsidy would be $6,236 per week for the 75% subsidy. And then the 10% subsidy, it would be up to $10,250 for the whole year. Or not the whole year, the whole 3 months, the 12 weeks. Again, the emergency business loan, our payroll is $750,000. So that would be above $50,000 and below $1 million. So on the surface, it would look like they should be able to apply for that loan. And then next slide. So again, this is another type of situation. I'm not going to go into this. It would basically work the same way. The potential subsidy, 75% subsidy in this case, if it would qualify, would go all the way up to $31,180. So it would be pretty big. But it would not qualify for the loan, the $40,000 loan, because its payroll is above $1 million. I'm now going to pass it off to Maurice. And if you have any questions, feel free to send them in.
Thank you, Marianne, and good afternoon, everybody. As noted at the outset, my job is to talk about some of the employment implications and offer a more broad overview of some of the options in terms of you being able to deal with your employees during this crisis. And it was noted at the outset, and I think it's true, these are truly unprecedented times for every employer in Alberta, and this COVID crisis is creating unique challenges in every workplace. So I thought I would start my presentation by putting just a few caveats in place What you're getting from me is a sort of 10,000 foot view of these various options. Each one of these options, however, in practice and at law, of course, needs to be assessed on its own facts, so it requires an individualized approach. There are really no one-size-fits-all solutions here. I think the Q&A session at the end of this webinar will be a good forum to answer some of the more particularized questions. But certainly what has been frustrating for us as employer-side lawyers and for employers is that the tools available to you as employers under our existing employment standards legislation, they weren't designed with the scale of this crisis in mind. So many of the things I'm talking about, many of these options are imperfect or frustrating to implement as a result of that. And Marianne already noted that scenery here is ever-changing. We've been seeing changes to legislation and different programs for relief daily, weekly, hourly in some cases. So you have to keep apprised of these things constantly. And quite frankly, not all the details are available to us. On the other hand, more of a silver lining, we think that because these are unprecedented times for employers, you'll get a little bit of help. You'll get help from the courts. Judges, I think it's fair to say, will give you some rope if there have been a few missteps. You'll get help from our legislature, who's responding to some of the legislative challenges in real time. And with those caveats in mind, here's what us management side lawyers have spent basically the last 3 weeks talking to employers about. On this first slide, we have some of the workplace solutions that we've advised employers on, and I've got them listed here in order sort of from popular to less popular, or workable to less workable in most workplaces. And I'll spend just a little bit of time talking about each point. The first point I have here is temporary layoffs and termination. And that's pretty much the most common or popular, if I can use that term, option used by employers. And just to put a little perspective on that, as of last week, I think Canada has seen over 1 million employment insurance applications due to layoffs and termination, which is a staggering amount. But the first thing to get clear about when we're talking about layoffs and terminations is to talk about the distinction between the two terms. Oftentimes we see the terms termination and layoff used interchangeably, but they're different at law. A layoff is a temporary solution. A termination is really a permanent one. And when you lay someone off, what you're really doing is suspending their employment for a period of time. The employee stays your employee, but their economic lives are put on hold, no pay, no benefits unless the employer offers that. And because the current assumption is that this COVID crisis and its economic impacts are temporary, most employers have relied on layoffs to sort of pause the employment relationship, to put it on hold, and then bring back employees late at a later time through a recall. As of Monday, there's been a change in Alberta in respect of how layoffs operate. That was in direct response by ministerial order to some of the challenges employers were facing. It used to be that your temporary layoff period was 60 days. You could lay off somebody for 60 days in a 20-day period. They've doubled that, so now the layoff period has been extended to 120 days. But what happens if you exceed that period and you don't recall somebody from a temporary layoff during that time period? The layoff, the temporary piece, turns into a permanent termination. And when that happens, you would owe your employee at that stage the whole complement of termination damages, pay in lieu of notice or a severance package, something of that ilk. Layoffs also, and this is important for employers to understand, come with some risk. In the non-union environment, at common law, courts have historically held that a layoff is effectively a constructive dismissal, so a termination. So a laid off employee could choose to resign and claim that whole complement of termination damages against you, but we think that the risk of that, both legally and practically, due to the current COVID environment, is very low. So we've been telling employers to proceed with layoffs where that's possible and convenient to do. The next couple of points, reducing hours and reducing wages and compensation, I'll kind of tackle those together. The legal issue that those changes engage is really the same that I was just talking about. It's a constructive dismissal question. An employer who makes unilateral changes to employment terms, for example, reducing hours, and the change being significant in nature or in scope takes the risk that the employee can refuse that change, resign, and claim that they've actually been terminated. But the key issue, of course, is that term I used, unilateral. If your employees agree to any of these changes that you want to implement, there's no problem. You can have an agreement with an employee to reduce the hours or to reduce their compensation. Employees can condone that change by accepting it and continuing to work. You can get that in writing or through an email exchange. It's generally fine. If you end up having a conversation with your employees to change compensation or hours, we recommend you put that in writing to the employee later and get their acknowledgement in writing that that's what's happening for a period of time. Practically, we think the risk with doing those kinds of things is also low. We think in the current environment, most employees will accept those kinds of changes because the alternative isn't ideal. Employees would have to, of course, resign and start costly litigation, which in the current environment is less than ideal thing to do. The other thing I'd like to talk about is the federal work sharing program. So this has been a popular tool for employers to implement. It's part of the federal offering of programs, and it's really designed to have employers avoid layoffs altogether. And what you do is you apply for it to Service Canada. It ends up becoming a tripartite agreement between the employer, the federal government, and the employees. The idea really in a nutshell is that you identify a group of employees, say your nurses, and they would work a reduced schedule and share all of the work equally amongst themselves. And it's backstopped by employment insurance. So the shortfall on the hours and the resulting compensation is covered to some extent by employment insurance. And so that's been a popular option for employers who just have less work, but want to keep people employed and make sure they don't take a full reduction in pay. I've also got furloughs on the slide. It's basically a leave of absence that you're mandating. We haven't really been recommending furloughs that much. It really works the best when employees just agree to it. It's basically a leave without pay, which typically you can't really implement. And it's has sort of the same result as a layoff, but it's not anchored in any legislation. So it creates a bit of a greater liability risk, which is why we haven't been advising employers all that much to use that. And the last point I have here is requiring the use of vacation and bank time. And so some employers have looked at that. The idea is you can ask employees and even compel employees to use banked time, like banked overtime, banked vacation time, to take it so they're off work and get paid. That works really well if you, for example, put people on vacation one day a week or something like that. You can kind of stretch that out. What's not ideal about it is because it really saves no money for the business in the immediate short term, which is typically the reason why you're looking at these kinds of solutions in the first place. And of course, employees don't like it because it drains their bank time. So they're kind of viewing themselves as funding their loss of pay during this crisis. So those are some of the options you have at your disposal to restructure things in the workplace. How you implement these or any combination of these gets complicated and depends on your contractual arrangements with employees, your operational needs and challenges, your relationships with the employees, a whole number of things. I'll go to the next slide, and here you'll see some of the government aids, government assistance programs aimed to help you deal with employee issues like I just talked about. I've talked about the federal work sharing program. Marianne gave you a very good summary of the wage subsidy. There's also something called the Supplemental Unemployment Benefit. And what this really is you make an application to the federal government, and if it's successful, if you're eligible, it allows you to basically top up a worker's EI. Employers use that basically to maintain some good faith with key employees who are being laid off. A lesser known maneuver that you can try is this EI-backed part-time work arrangement that I have on the last point of the slide. If you have someone who is receiving EI, so they've passed their waiting period and they're already receiving benefits, you have the option of bringing them back on reduced hours, and they get to keep 50% of their EI payment for every dollar that they earn. So it's a good solution where you have people laid off right now temporarily, and then the business kind of picks back up as the restrictions on businesses are being eased, and you can bring some people back part-time and ease the economic impact on them. On the next slide, I have a little bit of information on how to implement some of these options. And for most of these, there's a formal requirement. And the most important one to keep in mind is the formal requirements in respect of layoffs. If you lay somebody off temporarily, the law is, under our employment standards code, that you have to give notice of the layoff. And that notice has to be in writing. The notice has to stipulate that the layoff is temporary and when it becomes effective. And the layoff notice has to also attach in the letter section 62 to 64 of the Employment Standards Code. So you have to actually put the layoff sections from the code right into the notice. There's also an advance notice requirement. It's either 1 or 2 weeks advance notice of a layoff occurring, but Employment Standards has telegraphed that they're not really enforcing this right now due to the unforeseeable circumstances caused by COVID. So this is the requirement for layoffs. You have to issue this notice. In addition to that, in order to get your employees set up to apply for employment insurance, you have to issue a record of employment, an ROE. That is a requirement after an employee has a 7-day interruption in earnings, and it's what enables them to apply for EI. So on the ROE, the important thing to remember is you have to put a code to explain the reason for the layoff, and most codes that you'd be using for temporary layoffs would be code A for temporary shortage of work or shortage of work. And what we've heard and what we've been advising employers is don't put anything on there in terms of a comment, because that will take the application out of the queue and put it in front of a person at Service Canada, slowing everything down. For any of the other changes, like reducing compensation and all those kinds of things, there aren't any formal requirements for that, but we would always recommend that it starts with a conversation and then is backstopped with a letter to employees that includes some kind of sign off or acknowledgement. Question we often get is what happens when a layoff period expires. If you don't recall, as I mentioned, within the allowable period, then it turns into a termination. And so right now it's 120 days. We suspect that if this crisis continues to worsen or stay the same for that period, problems will probably step in and fix that and extend that period too. We'll have to see. But you also have the option to extend the layoff indefinitely. And you do that by continuing to pay into things like benefit program for the employee. And if you continue that over the course of the entire layoff period, the temporary nature goes away. And with the agreement of the employee, you can turn it into an indefinite layoff subject to recall by the employer. But you do need the employee's buy-in and agreement to that. Often we get the question, what if I screw this all up? What if I don't issue a written layoff notice? How do I fix it? As I mentioned, I think there's going to be a lot of forgiveness for employers in this current circumstances. If you lay people off and you don't have that in writing, you don't meet the technical requirements, our advice has been go back, issue a layoff notice now, explain that it didn't occur as a result of unforeseeable circumstances, explain that the layoff continues to be effective as of the original date that was provided, attach those sections from the code, and go forward from there. That can be dealt with later if it ever becomes an issue, which is probably unlikely. Generally, any errors that you identify in terms of process, we say go back in writing, put something on the record, remedy it. You do a letter to employees explaining that a mistake has been made, that should probably take care of it. The other two points on this slide I have are red flags. If you are implementing changes in the workplace and you come across these two issues, our view is you should get some alarm bells going off and you should consider talking to legal counsel. The first is people that are currently on self-isolation. People on self-isolation right now, if you have employees like that, those are on a job protected leave right now. You cannot legally lay them off or terminate them. You need to wait until the end of the isolation period. People that are sick or have childcare responsibilities now due to school closures, for example, you may need to accommodate those people under our human rights legislation up to the point of undue hardship. So you have to be careful in how you approach that. And one issue that's been creeping up a bit in the healthcare field generally, especially around the use of the N95 respirator, are issues with people just refusing to do work unless they have that PPE equipment available. If you get one of those, you should talk to counsel. It has all kinds of OHS implications, and you should speak to somebody about that. My last slide talks about supports for employees. As mentioned at the outset, these things are always changing. We don't have full information on all of these yet, but generally our advice has been, don't become your employee's financial advisor or life coach and start giving tips or advice on how to navigate all of these different benefits. You might be wrong, and it's better generally to have them make those decisions for themselves. But here are some of those benefits. The first is the CERB, or the Canada Emergency Response Benefit, that launched on Monday. This is really for people ineligible for EI, so most employees aren't going to be able to get that. It's for people who are not working due to COVID and have no income for at least 14 consecutive days. It provides $500 a week for up to 16 weeks. But like I said, most employees would probably not qualify for that due to EI. There's the job protect leave that I just talked about in terms of self-isolation, but there's no longer a benefit for that provincially. It's really now backstopped by employment insurance. And employment insurance is really the key. Most employees should be referred there. And there are other individual benefits for employees. They get tax deferrals, mortgage deferrals through certain banks, loan deferrals, and those kinds of things. But as I said, my advice has been to advise your employees that there are benefits available, but then having them explore those and make those financial decisions themselves. So that wraps up my part of the presentation, and I turn it over now to Dr. Wilson.
Hello, everybody. Sorry about the background light. It's not that great on my face. Well, that's been great. I was asked to be part of this as a representative of a specialist. You can see that I have one full-time assistant and then two part-time assistants. I think it poses a little bit of something maybe I'll throw out right away, or one of the things that I want some advice about is each of those part-time people, one works for another company and one works for Alberta Health Services. So my understanding is that, from my accountant, is that they can't apply for the CERB because of how much they make. So that's one thing that I need to get clarification about. So I'm mostly, for me, it's relatively straightforward as I'm a solo business and I have my own billings, and I can easily show that my wage or my income has dropped, or the PC's income has dropped. That's not going to be that much of an issue. The biggest thing that I do is I share space with pediatric cardiology. Of course, the financial impacts I've stated there. For my business viability, I mean, really, I think I counted about 5 referrals today, whereas I would have had a lot more. I have a backlog to go through, but the reality is that my business is way down, and I mean, assuming it will come back, but where I can, I will use some virtual care models, but this will only, you know, this will be much less than what I would normally do. The flexibility, my staff has been with me for a long time, and I do feel some, I think like a lot of physicians, we do feel a connectedness or whatever. We care about our staff as part of us, as the way we are with physicians. But you are going to have to think like a business person. And, I like this quote, begin to think like a businessman. After that, you can do whatever you want, prefer, even practice good medicine. So, you know, we are going to need advice. This is excellent what's been put together. It helps lay the groundwork, but all of us will have to, like going to get another consult from a colleague. You know, you're going to need to talk to your accountant, you need to talk to your banker, and you may need legal advice at all for all of this. And we shouldn't be afraid to do that. There are set steps in this process that have been outlined. It is a little bit of a moving target. I feel that I have been on a roller coaster. Am I temporarily laying off everybody? And then, you know, we've been waiting to hear what this 75-25% program comes out. So for me, I mean, I picked up the phone and I talked to my accountant, and I've gotten the best financial advice that I could get. So I think I'll leave it there. I've been watching the questions that are coming in. I think they're all excellent questions. Perhaps, one thing, you know, what I would like to hear, well, just it sounds as though the 75-25 is going to capture a lot of physicians from what I know, but it might be worth seeing what the McLennan-Ross people say in terms of what they think where most physicians will fit in and how, you know, maybe next steps is almost like a flow diagram that we could go through to actually help us make those decisions. So I'm going to turn it over to Daryl, and he's got a little more of a bigger clinic and can present further thoughts.
Thanks, Scott. Thank you, everybody, for taking the time to come out to this presentation today. I don't want to take too much time because the most important thing is to get the question and answer sessions from the guests and panelists that we have with us today. First of all, from the physician perspective on things, I wanted to just recognize the organizers of this presentation today. First of all, AMA as well as ACTT, who works under AMA, our presenters and all of our panelists that are just flurrying away with the answers. I really appreciate what you're doing for us as physicians. I also wanted to kind of appreciate and recognize the angst and concern that we have as physicians out there all over the province. And from a family physician perspective, we are getting hit significantly here. First, we have the cuts that have occurred, and now we have the pandemic issues that have occurred. And as I reflected in my slide, we're experiencing some significant loss at this point in time. Probably a 50% reduction in income or even greater for some people. And we are still getting news and concerns that there are clinics that could potentially close in bankruptcy over this next little while. In addition to that, we have a government who doesn't really want to work with us, unlike other governments across the country that seem to be wanting to work with physicians. So that being said, my clinic is just an example of what everybody's experiencing, and we're not much different than anybody. Larger clinic, we have 13 physicians with partners and associates. The biggest thing right now is that we're still awaiting our financial reports from this last month, and we have a lot of anxiety over the fact that we still don't have the fee codes put into our EMR so we can bill for this next month under the virtual codes. So everything is really up in the air, and we're doing the best we can to try and estimate what our losses are going to be. So we've reduced staff. We're trying to maximize our virtual care visits. We've closed one of our clinics. We've reduced our hours in our clinic. We're trying to retain funds and reviewing splits with our associates at this time. Probably the biggest thing right now I would say to people is first and foremost, you know, safety of ourselves, our staff, our families. Really have a look at your clinics. Despite our desires to be seeing patients in order to bill, try and reduce your visits as much as possible. As a medical director in a long-term care, I'm hearing news from other places that there's physicians that are still visiting these places or visiting assisted living. And we need to really be careful with that and make sure that we're looking at the best interests of our patients at this time. The big thing too is that despite all of this, it's not our fault. I mean, we've been hit hard and unpredictably. We're all in this at the same level, and we cannot really play a victim in this situation. We have to be very assertive and aggressive and try and do the best we can to get through this. Thank you, and I'm going to hand this back to Mark now so we can get to the question and answer session.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Lebiewicz. And I just want to acknowledge that you've raised a really important point here about physicians taking care of themselves, particularly in these difficult times. I would like to draw attention to the AMA's Physician and Family Support Program, which provides support to physicians, resident physicians, and medical students, as well as physicians' immediate family members. The PFSP provides confidential advice, support, and help with accessing necessary resources for personal or professional problems, including family and relationship issues, career, educational, and workplace concerns that are impacting your health, dealing with adverse events, stress, anxiety, other mental health issues, substance misuse, or concern for a colleague. The PFSP can be contacted 24 hours a day, 7 days of the week, any day of the year. This toll-free number, 1-877-767-4637. Additionally, we'd like to acknowledge that there's been a resource created by McLennan-Ross in support of the topics discussed today. These resources and this webinar recording and associated FAQs will be located at a link that is displayed at the link displayed on the screen. We will now proceed with responding to your questions. Remember that you can continue to type in your questions at any time. This presentation is being recorded and the Q&A will be available on the website. I'd like to invite Marianne Maurice, Drs. Wilson and LeBuick to come off of mute and have their cameras on. Participants, again, may continue to type their questions in. As a reminder, this webinar has been approved for up to one main pro credit. The evaluation link will be displayed in a web browser when you leave the meeting. So we'll get started with our first question, and recognizing that many of our participants today have different perspectives, urban, rural practice sizes, how those businesses have been constructed. We'll try to do our best to provide you as much detail, but maybe consider your responses in light of some of those differences. The first question I'll go to is a physician who's still not clear on their own clinic situation. Clinics are working very hard to avoid formal partnerships. Is this word being used formally or informally? And as my clinic is an association of professional corporations, the association has a business number and payroll is paid there. And we'll start with that, and then there's a follow-up related to what constitutes revenue in that situation as well.
I think the first place you need to do is you need to figure out where the employees are paid and then what is that legal entity. So if you have a payroll number, what has the payroll number? It's going to be some legal entity. So it will either be a corporation or it will be a partnership, essentially. There's not a lot of options. Now, the corporation may be a not-for-profit corporation. And that still potentially qualifies if it has the 70 or the 30% reduction or the revenue reduction. But you first have to figure out what is the entity. And you may have a situation where you have, for example, in a partnership, you have a partnership that has a payroll number and has had a loss of revenue. And then the partners could have professional corporations, which I call PCs, because that's what we usually refer to them in the tax world and the corporate world. And that could also, your PC could also have a loss of revenue. And if the partnership had the loss of revenue, then it could potentially claim those subsidy for its employees. And the PC, if the doctor is an employee, it could potentially claim the wage subsidy for the doctor, assuming the doctor was an employee and the arm's length rule doesn't get in the way. So you have to kind of figure out, well, where is the employee and who is their employer? Again, this is all subject to the 75% wage subsidy. We don't have the legislation yet, and there is a lot we don't know. As I mentioned quickly, and I know my presentation was very fast because there was a lot of information to go through, the government has acknowledged that and has said that they're going to come up with special rules for corporate groups, non-arm's length entities, and joint ventures. So if you have a structure, and I know from looking at the questions that people have raised that this is potentially a big issue for a lot of people, if you have a structure where the entity that pays the employees is not getting the majority of revenue, so it's only revenue is being transferred from the physician corporations, we're not sure what's going to happen yet for those situations. So I mean, if you're, as the physician, are billing AHS and your PC is billing AHS, and then you pay a set amount a month to cover your expenses that are to like a corporation that employs the employees, well, the amount that you're paying a month in theory is not going to change, even if your revenue has gone down. But the employer, being the clinic corporation, may not have had that drop of revenue unless you guys all reduce how much you pay. So this is a situation where the announcements to date do not seem to fully address it, but I'm hoping that because the government has acknowledged that corporate groups are not fully addressed by this, what's been announced to date, that we will get more. So I know that a lot of people aren't certain whether their clinic will qualify because of that, like potentially that revenue question. And I don't have the answer, unfortunately, but I'm hoping that they're going to be reasonable. And if they know about it, I suspect they will. Problem is, there's just so many different scenarios that they're trying to figure out right now. And I think they're trying to move so quickly that they may not even know that this is an issue. So, you know, maybe send an email to your MP or whatever. But yeah, so I hope that answered the question. I don't know if it did. Then we have a follow-up question, Mark.
Thanks, Marianne, and appreciate that that you're providing information as quickly as it's becoming available from government on policies. I guess then in the advice at this point, I think I'm hearing is continue to wait for more instruction or to continue to seek getting advice from your local experts as this information is evolving in a very rapid way. Is that the best advice we can give right now?
I mean, the 75% wage subsidy, you can't even apply for it right now. So I think I would still, my advice about make sure you have my business account, make sure that, you know, you're set up for direct deposits. That's, I think, still good across the board. Some people may know already, right? Like some people might be able to be like, yes, I am a corporation, check that box. I have employees, check that box. The corporation's revenue has gone down by the appropriate amount. And so they may be pretty confident that they already meet the test, and that's great for them. Some of these other more complicated situations and corporate structures, it may not be entirely clear. I'm optimistic that the government wants to keep people employed. So they seem to be trying to help people once they figure out it's an issue. So, I mean, this is a very common structure for doctors across the country. So I'm hoping that the government, and not just doctors, right? Other professionals as well. So I'm hoping that the government doesn't want to see, you know, mass layoffs in certain areas. So I'm hoping they'll address it, but we don't have the legislation. Like with the 10% wage subsidy, I have the legislation. I can look at it. I can look at the Income Tax Act and I can say, okay, this is how it works. I mean, we haven't had court decisions on it yet, of course, but I can get a pretty good idea. With the wage subsidy, all we have is like Trudeau and Bill Morneau standing up and saying things with, you know, finance releasing press releases. So we don't necessarily know how this is all going to work. And I agree, there is situations, and I know the Canadian Tax Foundation has identified some of them and mentioned them, where it's not clear that the subsidy will apply when it should, right? When you do have a business that has effectively lost the amount of revenue that they're saying, but the structure is such that the quote unquote employer may not have had a loss of revenue. So we hope that that's going to get addressed. But I can't say it has been because it has not yet.
Great. So thanks, Mary. And I believe you've answered this one, but maybe I'll just help try to make it as clear as we can. So for those physicians who do not own their clinic and are not involved in any employee issues directly, however, they themselves are seeing a significant loss of income, are they eligible as independent physicians for the support?
So again, you have to go, do you have an employee and do you have an employer? So if you have a professional corporation and you as the physician pay yourself salary rather than dividends, we don't have the legislation and there's a special rule for non-arm's length employees, but it sounds like it should apply as long as you've been doing that to date. So as long as you've been an employee since before March 15th, 2020, you should be able to apply for the subsidy. The problem is for physicians that are not employees, they're kind of out of luck. And if they pay dividends, so you'd be not employed if you just pay yourself dividends, for example, or if you don't have a professional corporation, right? So their response to like sole proprietors, which would be the case if you were a physician and you were just earning the money personally and you're not an employee, their response is the CERB. So that $2,000 a month that Maurice suggested. So in theory, you could claim the CERB as a physician, and you'd still be able to get that. But again, there's that issue of you have to have no work and under the current, what they've said to date. So there's issues with that as well. But the wage subsidy, I mean, if you're not an employee, you can't claim the wage subsidy and you have to have basically you have to be doing payroll source deductions and getting a T4 in order to be eligible for the subsidy.
Great, thanks, Marianne. I'll invite Norma Shipley, fees consultant with the AME, to also come on camera. We had some questions regarding some additional clarity on the virtual care codes that may be claimed and whether out of province can be claimed. Norma, can I have you maybe expand upon this a little bit? Are we able to get Norma on camera? There we go. No audio again, Norma. Sorry, we got the same issue again. So Marianne, I think this question will come back to you, so I'll have you come off of mute. Joel, if I can have you work with Norma to get the audio working, that'd be great, but I'll direct this question to Marianne. What if a physician works at more than one clinic? Does a physician need to prove a 30% drop in all the clinics or one only?
Again, you have to go back to who's the employee and who's the employer, right? So, I mean, if you're talking about can the physician claim the subsidy for themselves, let's assume the physician is an employee, then it doesn't matter what's going on at the different clinics. What matters is what revenue the PC is earning. So if the professional corporation is earning 30% less, then you could in theory claim the subsidy for the physician. In terms of the different clinics, again, you have to look at who's the employer and who's the employee. So if you're looking at all the employees at the clinics, you have to look at who all the clinic employees' employer is. And if each of those clinics has their own corporation, then again, you have to look at the corporation that is the employer's revenue. So, I mean, without knowing the different structure, you'd have to work your way through these specific problems. But that's, again, you have to kind of look at who's the employee and who's the employer and what's the employer's revenue.
So Marianne, if I hired a staff member after March 15th, would I be eligible for these benefits?
So again, don't have the legislation, but the understanding I have based on what's announced is that if it's a if it's an arm's length employee, so not like family of a shareholder or the shareholder, then you should be eligible. Now, we don't know how that's going to be calculated because they talk about pre-crisis earnings. So obviously, if you hired a new person, they're not going to have pre-crisis earnings, but the government has said they're eligible for the subsidy. So do you just apply the subsidy, whatever you decide they're hired at? We don't really know. But that seems to be what they're saying, is that you can hire new people and claim the subsidy, assuming they're not arm's length. So you can't just hire all your relatives and then claim the subsidy for all your relatives. Like that, they seem to be suggesting, is not gonna fly. And unfortunately for physicians who maybe were not paying themselves salary, it seems like they may not be able to say, oh wait, now I wanna claim the subsidy, so I'll pay myself wages now rather than dividends. And so that's unfortunate, because obviously, you know, if you're an employee, you can claim a subsidy, that would be nice. So yes, that's my understanding. In short, yes, you can hire new people and claim the subsidy. We just don't really know how that's going to work yet.
Great. So again, well, I think you're a popular, lots of questions for you, Marianne. So if I'm in a joint venture agreement where I share staff with other physicians, does the joint venture apply or do the individual docs apply? If an individual docs apply, how to proportion the staff, because two people can't claim the same full-time employee salary?
So this one, I'm even more confident we're going to get more information on, because the government has specifically said joint ventures are something that they're going to be providing special rules for. So I don't know what those special rules are going to be. So the short answer is I don't know. However, unlike the cost sharing corporation, where I'm sort of hoping they're going to say things, they've pretty explicitly said that joint ventures special rules are coming. So I expect guidance for that situation to come up.
Have you received any advice or guidance on when the work sharing will start and whether it would be available to clinic managers or assistant managers?
That would be Maurice.
Yeah, you can apply for it right now, and that program has been in place for some time. What they've done is, if you have a current work sharing agreement or arrangement in place, and you want to amend that or change that, you don't have a waiting period on that. They've waived it for the variation on that piece. If you're applying for a new one, there's, I think, something like 30 days or something before they get back to you as to the appropriateness of the work sharing arrangement. The goal of a work sharing arrangement is to maintain core employees. And so it's not entirely clear to me whether specific managers in the clinic would be caught by it, but I would assume they would be, because the goal of it is to maintain the essential functions of the clinic or any employer really. And if those people are essential, then that works. And if they have overlapping functions, then it seems to me to be at least meeting the spirit of the whole work sharing agreement, because the goal of it is to share the similar tasks equally among an employee group. So my sort of hedged answer on that is, I think you can and should apply for it now, and those employees would be captured.
Thanks, Maurice. Next question, are there any downsides to using the $40,000 small business loans offered by the federal government?
The big downside is you have to pay it back. So, I mean, from that perspective, I think that, you have to talk to your bank. I would anticipate the banks are going to want personal guarantees, because they usually do, though I don't know. So it's going to be a business decision. It's like any debt you take, you need to decide, is this worthwhile? If you're reasonably confident your business is going to pick up again, which I imagine a lot of doctors it will, because I mean, there's probably a lot of people who aren't coming to see you right now, but they still have problems and they're still going to deal with them eventually. So in that case, maybe the $40,000 loan is a good deal. The no interest is a really good deal, but for some businesses, if they're not sure they're ever going to get going again, the $40,000 is just potentially one more debt that's going to be hanging over their head, right? So it is a business decision, and it's going to be a business decision each individual business is going to have to make.
Great. So Miriam, we know that we have some physicians who are not incorporated, but are self-employed individuals. Can you highlight what, if any, programs or supports they would have access to?
So unfortunately, all they really have access to is the CERB at this point, because most of what the programs that have been announced to date are related to employees, right? So if you don't have an employee, and obviously if you're a sole proprietor, you don't, then there's going to be potentially, there's going to be not a lot you can claim other than CERB. So, I mean, it's theoretically, and the CERB, as I think Maurice explained, you just need to show $5,000 of income before and to say it's gone, right? So you could have a ridiculous situation where your 18-year-old daughter, who no longer is working at the Gap, is eligible for the exact same CERB subsidy or payment as a doctor, right? So that's kind of what we've got. The CERB to date is you have to have no income. The government has suggested that's going to change, but they seem to be suggesting 10 hours a week is going to be the cutoff. So you might be able to be working 10 hours a week and still get it. But again, it's going to be $2,000. So most professionals, lawyers and doctors and accountants, all of us, $2,000 a month is maybe a lot less than we normally earn. So that's not necessarily going to mean a lot, but that seems to be all that's available at this date.
Great. Thanks, Marianne. One of the situations that physicians encounter is that when they submit their billings, they're generally for the previous month. And so I think any advice and guidance around how they demonstrate their revenues for March, recognizing that March revenues are probably reflective of February. Is there any advice and guidance you could provide on that?
So the revenue test is something that a lot of people have questions about right now. And I mean, initially the government said that you use your normal accounting method, and then they came back and said, okay, you can use the cash method or the accrual method. And for most people, the normal accounting method is the accrual method. So I think what people are going to have to do is they're going to have to take a look at, does the cash method or the accrual method work better for them? And the cash method is essentially cash in, cash out. So, you know, if your March, like if your cash is look like, you'll just have to just compare the two methods. So, I mean, if you're getting money for March in April, maybe you want the accrual method because your April accruals will be lower. And even though your cash is coming in from later, or vice versa, like if you're expensing and the cash is coming in later and you're not getting cash. So I think you have to look at the two methods, talk to your accountant. You'll probably have a good idea if you look at your cash flow and are like, oh shoot, cash flow is down. It's down 15% in March and 30% after that, then cash method is going to be fine. The accrual method is a little more complicated and you might need to look at, you know, your accountant and your bookkeeper and figure out if that works. But unfortunately, you're going to have to pick one and stick to it. So that's, you'll just have to decide which is going to work better with your business.
Great. Thanks, Ryan. Again, I think we've covered this, but we'll make sure we're really clear. So in a situation where a physician has an incorporated practice operated by the physician and the spouse, there are no employees, there are no salaries, only dividends being paid to shareholders, but are now experiencing a large drop in revenue. In this situation, are they out of luck from government supports?
That's my understanding. Other than potentially like the CERB, as I said, because again, we'll see what happens with non-arm's length employees and what the government announces. Like maybe they'll do something like if you're the one who's actually been doing the work, you can give yourself a salary. But based on what we have to date, you can't suddenly start employing yourself. So you can't claim the 75% subsidy or the 10%, same thing, because you're not a salary employee.
Great. I see, Norma, that you've rejoined. Can I just have you come off of mute and check your camera, make sure we got everything sorted out?
Yes. Thanks, Mark. How's this?
You're going to have to speak up. You're a little bit quiet, but I think that we can hear you now, Norma.
Okay. That's great. Thank you very much. So I'm going to speak to three questions that seem to have some concern among the group. One is related to virtual codes and whether they are part of the 50 and 65 cap that applies in urban and surrounding areas. Those codes, the virtual codes, are not part of the 50 cap, and Alberta Health has indicated that very clearly in communications to both physicians and to the AMA. In terms of out-of-province patients and whether you can claim the virtual codes for those patients, please know we've asked Alberta Health to clarify that. We are awaiting their response. We continue to remind them that that is an issue for physicians because you do care for patients who either may be resident in Alberta and but insured in another province or who reside in catchment areas that are part of the border towns. We will advise and publish something on Billing Corner as soon as we have a clear answer from Alberta Health. Regarding the cap, to just speak a little bit further to that, just a reminder that that applies in Grand Prairie, Fort McMurray, Edmonton, Red Deer, Calgary, Medicine Hat, and Lethbridge, as well as the surrounding areas for Calgary, Airdrie, and for Edmonton, Devon, Leduc, Sherwood Park, and Stony Plain. What's included in that? Alberta Health, in their bulletin published on March 30th, stated that it includes any V category. So that means a visit, a phone call, or a communication with another physician, except for the PUVA codes. Those are the ultraviolet treatment codes done by dermatologists in either the physician's office, their home, the patient's home, or a non-registered facility, and those are designated assisted living and assisted living facilities. So any services in those locations will count toward your 50 and 65 cap. Regarding business continuity, there were a few questions about that. Please know that the AMA continues to have very pointed and clear discussions with Alberta Health about that issue and about the need for support for physicians to ensure not just that you are remaining a viable business and service for your patients in this time, but also that we don't lose that infrastructure for healthcare over the period of the pandemic. And we continue to have those discussions with them. At this point, Alberta Health has not made any commitments about that, but please know that we do continue to raise that and to press them very hard on that. Are there any other questions, Mark, that you have?
I think we'll proceed, Norma, but thank you for that clarification. We may get some more questions coming through the Q&A now. Maurice, I think I've got a next question that might be coming your way. In this regards to layoff, and specifically a question regarding sometimes staff specifically request to be laid off so they can apply for the government benefits. How would you approach this? Are there any templates available that would support physicians and practices for issuing layoff notices?
Yeah, sure. So that happens a lot. It's called a voluntary layoff. And it makes this whole layoff process much more risk-free for you. And it's totally appropriate to do that. So when an employee requests a layoff, you can provide it. And you would simply paper it similar to how you would paper it if you were unilaterally imposing the layoff. So there would be a layoff notice. It would confirm that the employee has request and you're granting a voluntary layoff. It would conform with the formal requirements. So you would put the commencement date of the layoff. You would put the sections of the code that apply, 62 to 64, in that layoff notice. And you can talk to the employee about how the rest of the particulars about the layoff would work. Are they going to take out their vacation time now that they've accrued? Are they going to have their benefits continue? All those kinds of things. And in terms of there being a template, I think if you go on the Employment Standards website, they might have a template available through Employment Standards. Of course, your legal counsel may have a template available, and you can request them from them, specifically tailored to your situation. But there should be some available if you do some online searches, and I'm fairly certain if you look at the Employment Standards resource on temporary layoffs, they may have posted something on that already.
Great, thank you. I'm going to note that we've got 5 minutes left for the session, so I think we'll be able to do maybe one, maybe two questions more, and then we'll close. As a reminder, questions that we aren't able to answer during the session, we will keep those questions and endeavor to provide an FAQ. I'm recognizing that some of the questions there is currently no answers for, and that information is changing rapidly. This question is around an employee who is returning from an extended medical leave. How do you transition an employee from an illness EI to a layoff EI?
Yeah, typically what you do is you'd issue another record of employment. So the employee that's on an illness leave, typically would be looking to an employer for accommodation in terms of a return to work. They'd be looking to be placed back in their original position. If there are residual issues and limitations in terms of what they can do for work, they might look for an accommodation. But in the circumstances where you might be considering a layoff, you would give an employee like that a layoff notice in the ordinary course. And then in association with that layoff notice, you would be issuing an amended ROE. The amended ROE would change the dismissal code from, I think it's D for disability, to A for shortage of work. Just as a general comment, as I'm talking about these codes, if you have employees that want to claim EI or things like self-isolation leave, for example, you would use D or whatever the code is for illness and disability, because it waives the waiting period for EI, so you can speed that process up for your employee. But for the purposes of an employee returning for medical leave, if you switch over the benefit, that's going to get administered internally at Service Canada, and there may or may not be a change in how the EI benefit is calculated, but it's fairly simple. And I think most of the record of employment changes you can do online if you're filing records of employment electronically.
Great. Thanks, Maurice. I know we've got a few more questions, but we'll get one more in here. It's also related to layoffs. So what is my responsibility if we did a temporary layoff and when the employee was called back in writing that she refused to due to COVID fears? What's the responsibility of the employer in that case?
Yeah, so that's a great question. The answer is a bit complicated. Typically, it's difficult, I think, from an occupational health and safety perspective for most employees to refuse to work just because they're worried about COVID. They have to actually it has to be an actual legitimate safety concern that the employer that is subject to the work refusal has failed to mitigate in some manner. The difficulty work refusals like that present is that they end up falling under a specific section of our occupational health and safety regulations. There's a specific provision in there that allows employees to refuse unsafe work, and the insistence of the employer to put an employee to work in those circumstances can lead to an occupational health and safety investigation, which is onerous and can lead to forced closures and things like that. And of course, you have a government person coming into your workplace and auditing you. And there's a pretty onerous response that typically has to occur, where you have to have a site assessment done with various people from management, and the employee has to be shown what protocols are in place and what aspects of the workplace have been modified to mitigate safety risks and all of that. So if you do end up getting a work refusal, I think the first step is you ought to talk to an occupational health and safety lawyer to see if you can't open up a bit of a communication to occupational health and safety themselves to see how that ought to be handled. Most of these, what our experience has been, is that occupational health and safety is generous to employers, is allowing these kinds of work refusals, but they will dispatch somebody to come to your work site to basically tick their boxes and ensure they've done their own due diligence on these kinds of claims. But you should definitely get some advice from a health and safety professional.
Great. Thank you again so much for that, Maurice. In closing, I would like to extend our thanks to our physician members for participating in this webinar, the AMA board for their continued support of these offerings, our presenters today, Ms. Marianne Loney, Mr. Maurice Strandfeld, Drs. Wilson and Drs. LeBuick. We've put up contact information here should you require it. That brings us to the close of today's webinar. Please stay safe and healthy. Goodbye.